Lily lived alone in an old wooden cottage with a big, beautiful garden. She had white hair, a black cat, and grew the tallest sunflowers and the sweetest, reddest strawberries. At the very southern end of Lily's enormous garden was an ancient fig tree. The children of the town often saw Lily muttering to the old tree and her cat, so they called her the fig tree witch, and they called her cottage the witch's house. Each year, the stories grew about the spells she'd cast, the witch's brew she made, the broom she flew on, and the frogs in her yard that used to be kids. The fig tree was like an old friend to Lily. She sometimes said to herself, "Oh, you're a silly old woman, Lily, talking to a tree." But somehow she just knew it really was listening. The tree had grown there long before Lily had bought that house, long before white people had come to settle in the valley. That fig tree had grown there back in the long ago days when Aboriginal people used to dance their sacred dances by firelight nearby. Sometimes Aboriginal mothers had birthed their babies under that grand old tree, and so over the years, the tree had soaked up some magic. Under the fig tree was a hand-carved wooden bench seat. The wood was worn smooth where the old woman would sit to rest and chat to the tree. She'd munch on something from her garden as she sat, a mandarin, some strawberries or snow peas. Their conversations went like this. "Looks like that old passion fruit vine will give fruit for another year. Oh, when I dug in that bed over there yesterday, where I've used the new brew, oh, the soil, it's full of earthworms. Well, the strawberries are calling. They want their old brown leaves taken away and a bit of a feed before the sun goes down. I wonder if it'll rain tomorrow." And nodding to the tree, she'd get back to work. Every month on a Saturday, Lily had a stall at the town markets. She sold fresh eggs from her hens, flowers, vegetables and fruit as they came into season in her garden. Oh, but the thing she was really famous for was her delicious, fat strawberries. They always sold out quickly. In winter, at the start of the strawberry season, Lily would watch the strawberries closely to see when they would ripen. She chatted to the tree about how she would have strawberries and cream for breakfast the next morning. But there was someone else watching those strawberries ripening. Four schoolchildren had noticed them on their way home from school. They hung over the fence, saying,
"Oh, wouldn't it be great to have some of those strawberries?"
The temptation grew and grew in those children, until one day they said to each other,
"The old woman always goes to bed in the afternoon. After she goes to bed, we could sneak over and have a few of the strawberries."
"But what if she turns us into a frog?"
"Well, you don't have to come if you're chicken."
"Oh, all right. After she goes to bed then."
So that afternoon, after they saw the old woman draw her curtains, those kids snuck over the fence, ran quietly past the hens in the chook yard, and into the strawberry patch. Oh, but those strawberries were so red and sweet and juicy. The kids forgot all about having just a few and kept on eating.
"Oh, and just one more."
Suddenly, they realised they'd eaten every ripe strawberry and every half-ripe strawberry in the strawberry patch.
"Oh no, let's get out of here in case she catches us."
Then they ran off as fast as they could. Early next morning, Lily came down to feed her hens and pick some fresh strawberries for breakfast. But to her surprise, there was not even one half-ripe strawberry left. "Oh, dear. Maybe the birds ate them. No, they always leave little bits. And then she saw the little footprints. Oh, it looks like it was children. Didn't you see anything, Sooty? Oh, you never wake me unless you want something. I need a dog. But I don't really want a dog, do I, Sooty? I've got you and the chooks and the frogs.
Meow,
said Sooty. A few days passed and a new crop of strawberries were ripening. The four kids saw that they didn't get turned into frogs or caught, and they were starting to feel a little bit clever. So when they saw the strawberries getting ripe again, they winked to each other. As before, they waited for the old woman to draw her curtains. Then they snuck over the fence, past the hens in the chook house, and into the strawberry patch. They were just about to reach for those fat strawberries when there was a swishing and a swooshing, a creaking and a cracking, and down, down came the branches of the tree. It grabbed those children by the seat of their pants and hoisted them high, high up into the air.
Help, help, let us down, let us down.
The noise woke up Lily. She opened her curtains to see the strangest sight she had ever seen. There, high in the branches of the fig tree, were four terrified children, their faces as white as the moon, their underpants pulled high up to their waists, and their legs pedaling like mad in the air. Lily shook her head, chuckling. Oh, dear. That does look very uncomfortable. Then she hurried down to the tree. Thank you, tree. You better let them down now. The tree branches swooped downwards, dropping all four children to the ground. But before their feet even hit the ground, they were running as fast as the wind, past the chook shed, out of the garden, over the fence, and away to their homes. Lily hugged the tree. Oh, dear tree, you have been listening all these years. I never heard of a guard tree before. She went to bed chuckling, and in the morning woke with a smile. After breakfast, Lily heard a knock at the door. Four nervous children were standing in front of her, holding a basket with food and flowers from their gardens. They had been so shaken when they got home that they had all confessed to their parents. Their parents didn't believe their stories of swooping trees, but they did send them to apologise to Lily. After what had happened with the tree, the four children were worried they might end up as frogs, so their knees were knocking.
We came to say sorry we stole your strawberries. This stuff is for you.
Lily stood quietly, pursing her lips. It was wicked of you to steal from me. But I admire your courage for coming to say sorry. Especially, as some kids in this town say, I could turn you into frogs if I wanted to. Then she smiled, winked, and invited them in. Over morning tea, the children found out that Lily needed some help in her garden. So, two of the children would visit her some afternoons to help Lily after school, and they learned how to grow juicy, sweet, fat strawberries. Lily proudly showed them the special brew she made to feed her plants, but they pulled faces and held their noses when she lifted the lid on the bucket. Because it was made from horse poo, chicken poo, weeds, herbs and water brewed in the sun. She showed them the flowers she grew to attract bees, butterflies and ladybirds, and the frog pond she'd built because she loved frogs. There aren't any frogs about now. It's too cold. They'll be back in late spring. The children stared wide-eyed at her. But no, none of them were ever children before, if that's what you're wondering. They all had a good giggle then. When they all stopped for a rest, usually they'd squeeze onto the garden bench and chat about this and that. By the time they were grown-ups, two of those four children had become keen gardeners. So when Lily died, she left her house and garden to them. They decided to call it Fig Tree Gardens and made it into a community garden. Lots of people came to work in it, and each family had their allotment, their own part of the garden, though everyone worked together at working bees. No one ever saw the old fig tree move again, except sometimes, just sometimes on a windless afternoon, someone might catch, out of the corner of their eye, a branch moving.
Hey, did you just see that? That branch moved up and down. I'm sure it did. Did you see that?
You might visit there one day. It still is a community garden, and it's still beautiful. Frogs still have tadpoles in the frog pond in summer. The fig tree is even bigger and shadier now, so some of the garden plots had to be moved into the sun, into the front yard. The bench is even smoother from all the gardeners who rest there. One day, I got to sit on that bench, and I got told the story. Though they had changed it a bit over the years. Then again, maybe I've changed it a bit over the years. I wonder, how would you tell that story? The story of Lily and the fig tree.